Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're live from the SEC studios in White Bear Lake. We're glad to have you here. And, you know, for last week's show, I wasn't here, obviously, that saw last week's show, because there's so much going on at the legislature, in this case in the Senate, regarding taking away your constitutional rights to vote for judges. And as I would say, you're taking away your constitutional right to vote. So I wanted to testify down there, and I was testifying when the show was on. It's too bad we couldn't be live from down there at the Capitol. One of these days we'll figure that out. However, what I did show you was the hearing in the House that took place on taking away your right to vote and some of the testimony that went on there, and you got an extended vision of the hearing. And I just think it's utterly fascinating, the spin, the political nature of it, trying to say the judiciary is not political when it totally is. It's unavoidable. And then also you saw a little clip of Dan McGrath talking about the new election bills that are being put out there, which as they're written now, if they get voted on and passed, would be unconstitutional. So I just find it fascinating information. I think these are the darkest days for Minnesota that we've ever seen. The attack on our family, the attack on our rights, the attack on integrity for the election process in Minnesota is unbelievably bad. I would call it evil. I'll call it evil. It's evil what's going on down there right now. Plus then we get a court case that comes out today or this week, that foster parents get kids over the grandparents, over family, when the court found that there was nothing wrong with the grandparents. You know, we've been down this road before. We're going to describe that a little bit today, that Supreme Court hearing, what took place. We're also going to talk a little bit about the appointment of David Lilyhaug to the Minnesota Supreme Court and the problem that is. It's a totally political appointment, obviously, and it's at the worst extremes, because you know why? You didn't get to vote for it, and our Constitution says you do. And Justice Paul Anderson, who resigned so that the appointment could be made instead of you, the people, getting to vote on who you want for your Supreme Court justice. This is terrible. This is planned. It's political. And Paul Anderson, you're wrong for doing this. You're abusing our Constitution, as you'll hear in testimony and see in video today. So most of the time we're going to look at video from the Senate hearing that I testified in about taking away your right to vote. And then at the end of the show, we're going to talk about Maplewood and trying to take away this show and other shows like it. Because they don't like the information you're getting. They don't like the transparency that is happening to expose the people of Maplewood and the surrounding cities to what's taking place in Maplewood. So they're going to take their ball and run away and go home. And, you know, they have the same chance to be on the air. And matter of fact, they got more hours and more time than anybody else, yet they choose not to do anything with it or very little with it. And they don't like what we're saying, so they're going to run away and pull the plug. You know, real grown up there. You know, but that's what we get in Maplewood for our employees there and some of our city council members. Okay, we're going to get right into this constitutional amendment and the hearing that took place in the Senate. But to set this up, I want you to see that this is a conversation that is going on. This is going on all around the state, this constitutional amendment. You may not be hearing it because the major press has not covered it to a very much extent right now. Even though there's been a hearing in the House and Senate, I've seen very few articles on it. And it's mostly the minor presses that are talking about it. But Peter Fisher, the representative from part of Maplewood, Matamidi, part of White Bear Lake and surrounding cities, Willerney, had a town hall meeting last Saturday, and I was there to tape that. And one of the questions, of course, I wrote a question about the constitutional amendment, which Peter Fisher signed on to. He's in support of this. And you're going to see his excitement in his answer. So the question was, where are you standing on this constitutional amendment, take away our right to vote, and why, and would you take your name off of it? And here is Peter Fisher's response.
What it would do is it would take and formalize the current system that we have right now in some regards. Is right now when there are vacancies within the judicial system, this is something that's evolved under both parties, both Republican and Democrat, is that a panel is put together. The panel selects, takes interview resumes from people across the spectrum, and it's a panel of experts, and they interview the people there, and they make a recommendation of their top three people to the governor, and then the governor appoints. What we have now is, due to Citizens United and everything, is we have the process where parties can now start getting involved in the process and endorsing both sides, and which would greatly change the landscape. What this bill here does, and takes it back into a situation where you have the opportunity of voting a person. The way I understand the bill that I've been signed on to is that it would take the opportunity away from where we'd be saying, well, we've got right now, we have person A, who's John Doe's on the ballot, who may be the incumbent, then Jane Doe runs, and nobody really knows too much what's going on in those situations. What it would turn into would be a situation where you'd have your judge on there, it would be a retention. Do you think this person should stay in or not? And what I like about that is because at that point in time, if you feel that person's not good, we're able to have them take them out. But I don't have the legal expertise, and a lot of times what I've done on judicial elections where we've got competition going on, is I talk to my friends who are attorneys and say, what do you know about these judges? And that's how I try to source it out. Where with this new process, you would go to retention, boy, this person is good, we voted out. But what we do then is we go back into the process that we had before, is where a group of people come together who are experts on it, who are able to take a look at it at a fair process, establish the standards, come up with the recommendation, go forward in that process. I think that's a great win-win. It ensures we have great processes. And where I've seen it work great is over the years, we've seen some very tough decisions come before the Supreme Court, some of them involving elections. Back when Arne Carlson was running, there was a position. He was not originally the endorsed candidate at that point in time. There was an unfortunate situation. The Republican field lost their candidate just several weeks before the election. And the Supreme Court, which was made of Democrats at the time, turned around and said, you know, that's not fair. This is the person that they want to put on the ballot. Go ahead and put him on the ballot. So, and this is why I have faith in that kind of system, because it was very obviously not a party-dominated system when they said to the Republican Party, and this person ended up becoming governor. And we've had other instances. When Wellstone died, we kind of went through the same process. Once again, the Supreme Court said, let's go ahead and do this. And this was a Supreme Court that was not dominated by Democrats that did it. And that's why I feel very strongly about that, is it helps take the politics out of the partisan politics out of it, and lets people focus more on the qualifications that has given us a very strong and normally a very fair system throughout. We're not perfect, but I think we're much better than some.
All right, so you can see he's pretty excited about this, and he makes a lot of statements there. I think he gives an accurate portrayal about the system. And he says, it makes the system the way it already is, which is fascinating to me because that's not the way our Constitution says it's to be. So what's happening is these judges are usurping the Constitution and designing the system the way they want it to be, where they don't get the scrutiny, they don't have to run, they don't have to have challengers. They've manipulated this so much that it makes our judicial system a joke. And they purposely, as Peter Fisher says, or Representative Fisher says, he didn't say they purposely, but nobody knows about these judges. And how do you find out that information? You're asking somebody else. But this is purposeful. The judges don't want you to know about them. And I just spent over 45 minutes today trying to figure out who was the judge that made the decision on this, that foster parents get the kids rather than the grandparents, when there's no difference between them. And the grandparents are found to be fit. Who was the judge? It took me 45 minutes. You know, I couldn't find it on the judicial website, web pages. Couldn't find the case. I found the Supreme Court case, the appellate court case. I found those judges. Couldn't find the district court judge. Couldn't get into that case number. Finally found it through a different article and doing some Google searches. City Pages had a great, great rundown on this case. And they need to do a follow-up now that the order came out. This is bad, people. You grandparents, you got to get up in arms about this. This is a terrible decision that was made. We'll tell you who the parties are here in a little bit. Okay. Now, remember, this retention appointing of judges didn't work well in Iowa. You know, because the governor voted for very liberal judges. They said, hey, these judges said you can have gay marriage, and the people rose up. There was $1 million spent on these retention elections. Big money came in because of the retention election. Big money wasn't there before. And the people voted those judges out. Now, if these three of the judges out, the other four weren't up for election. Okay, that's coming here very soon. But the judges made that decision against the will of the people. So now the governor appoints, depending on who the governor is, he's going to appoint three more liberal judges or three conservative judges. In this case, in Iowa, there was a change in governor, so the new governor, who was more conservative, voted through three conservative judges. Did it take politics out of the situation doing retention elections? Not one bit. But because there is exposure, there was transparency, to some regard, people can see the political nature. Now they see it, only the people didn't have a say. Only one person had the say, not the people. Okay, so let's go then to, well, I spoke down at the Senate hearing, and so let's go to my opening statement and see what I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Tim Kinley, Senators. I am amazed that you want to take away my right to vote. It's appalling to me. We spent last year dealing with a constitutional amendment dealing with photo ID, and the complaint was some people might not be able to vote. But now you're going to take away everybody's right to vote. It's amazing to me. And I'll never give up my right to vote. Now, I just want us to remember, what was the cost to obtain a right to vote? Revolutionary War, for Minnesota specifically, the Dred Scott decision. And Minnesotans decided to go and say, hey, you know what, we need another level of accountability here, and that's our right to elect judges. I'll never give up my right to vote.
This other level of accountability was due to judges not following the Constitution, not following natural law, natural rights in this Dred Scott decision. And we in Minnesota said, hey, you know, appointment's not bad, okay? It's not necessarily a bad thing, but we need a better way to get judges out sooner. And we decided to go with the election process, where that's the primary goal, electing judges. Otherwise, we do the federal system, they're on the bench forever. And Thomas Jefferson had some very, very good quotes about the judiciary, which we'll bring to you over time here. But he said, the appointment system is a terrible system. It's the bottom line. What we do, judges will end up abusing the system and they will form an oligarchy. And that's exactly what is trying to happen in Minnesota right now, because the accountability will be taken down to, I mean, the governor appoints. There's no checks and balances on the governor appointment. 6 years later, there might be. But then it depends on who the governor is. The governor might like what the judge did in making their decision, or might not mind their drunken driving behavior, whether they took a life or not. That doesn't matter. I still want them in. So this gives that extra level of accountability that we the people need. Now, let's go on to our next clip here as we, the right to vote is precious, people. Don't give it up. It comes at a great cost to get back. And this is very simply, let's take it away. Oh, big deal. No, you got to fight for this. You got to stand up. And I actually, when we get into the Maplewood situation where I talked about Mr. Antonin, a veteran, doesn't understand what free speech is about. He should as a veteran, but you veterans need to understand about what's happening here and taking away your right to vote for judge. You need to step up on this place. This is appalling. You need to step up and say no and stop this. All right, let's see the next clip here that I talked about.
Now, I hear a lot about, well, first of all, then there's another problem with giving up our right to vote. And Greg Wurzel sent you an email, should have been put in all your packets. It's a four-pager document. And he wanted me to relay to you the problem with retention elections is they'll violate the 14th Amendment. And if I take and just talk about Section 2 of the 14th Amendment and deal only with the issue that relates to judges, it reads, representatives shall be apportioned among several states according to the respective numbers, but when the right to vote at any election for judicial officer of a state is denied, this would be a denial, or in any way abridged, this would be an abridgment, the basis of representation therein in the House of Representatives shall be reduced. Now, one state has already filed, I shouldn't say state, some plaintiffs have already filed against the state of Missouri. They thought a bill was going to go through that would change the retention elections, and it didn't. So, I mean, they pulled it off the table why they thought it was going to go through. It didn't go through, so now they're bringing it back on. There's no case law on these issues. It's blank. Okay, but Greg will sue. But why go there? Why take away our right to vote?
Yeah, why do this? It's amazing. Now, just to be clear, there is a lower U.S. court decision. Richardson is part of it, where this is discussed on the periphery, where a federal district court judge said, why would a state do this? Because it will jeopardize their representation in the U.S. House of Representatives. I'll get that case for you. But so there is, it's a blank slate out there in regards to this issue. Now, I raised the issue. Of course, Greg's been doing some work behind, Greg Wurzel, who wrote up the documents, been doing some work behind the scenes. He's the person that went and sued Minnesota Judiciary and the Board on Judicial Standards for their ethics violations that deny the free speech rights of people running for judge. Can you believe that? Minnesota, our judiciary is so ethical that they deny free speech to lawyers and to people running for judicial office. That's how ethical they are. It's just disgusting. Okay, and so Greg Wurzel had to sue and go and lost all the way up to the Supreme Court where he won in a 5-4 decision that's saying, yeah, I suppose people running for office have free speech rights to get people to endorse them and state their views on whatever they are. You know, that's just how pathetic it is in our country right now and in our judiciary. Their desire to grab all this power and to control the people in their system and their officers of the court. That's how bad it is. Well, Senator Lemmer picked up on the 14th Amendment issue, and here's his first comments and dialogue that took place.
Before I vote, I was just wondering, we've had a number of testifiers have given testimony regarding an issue regarding the 14th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution regarding in the event that the right to vote of an election of judicial officers of a state, if it's denied or any way abridged, could be the basis, or would be the basis of representation in the House, the Congress, shall be reduced. Do you have any comment, Senator Ress? How do you handle a 14th Amendment in light of this decision?
Mr. Chairman, Senator Lemmer, there are any number of states that have retention elections, and the right to vote is not being abridged in any of them either.
Okay. Senator Ress didn't answer the question, or didn't answer it correctly, or misstated it. There are many, some, I think two states that have retention elections. The answer was about taking away your representation in the U.S. House of Representatives through denying a person the right to vote for. It says for a judge, not against, but for the person you want to have in that office, to vote for somebody in a contested election. And Senator Ress said, well, nobody's rights have, the 14th Amendment hasn't been violated. That's her answer. Well, the issue is nobody's challenged these states based on the 14th Amendment. Because believe me, very few people read the Constitution, even lawyers, even judges. And you have some that have a twisted, like Paul Anderson, who resigned, a twisted view of how the Constitution is to be read. And we'll get into his twisted view in a little bit. But Senator Ress gave the answer, of course, there's no case law. So that was an easy thing to answer in that regard. And everybody's had their representation. All right. But not in Minnesota. We will sue. Case is already set, ready, set to go. Okay, let's hear what Senator Lemmer has to say next.
In the other states that have retention elections, has there ever been a challenge based on the 14th Amendment? And has that really been properly, or not properly, but completely discussed by higher court?
Senator Lemmer, as I heard the commentary about the 14th Amendment, it applies to districts for election to the United States House of Representatives and is not at all related to election of judges within a state.
Well, Mr. Chair, why don't I just read a one-liner here. 14th Amendment, Section 2 states, when the right to vote at any election for the choice of electors for President, Vice President of the United States, Representatives in Congress, the Executive, and judicial officers of a state or the members of the legislature therein is denied to any inhabitants of such a state or in any way abridged, the basis of representation therein shall be reduced. So they do make reference in federal constitution or the U.S. Constitution regarding the judicial officers of a state.
This question was to Senator Rest. But did you hear the chair of the committee, Senator Latz, come in and answer the question to take it off Senator Rest? It's a maneuver that happens. You know, all right, that's okay. I mean, you want to get an answer. But Senator Latz here, I read the 14th Amendment, Section 2. He heard it, and I said, talked about where it just talked about judges. And there he goes and says, there's nothing in the federal constitution that talks about elections of state judges. Well, wait a second. Okay. Now Senator Lemmer reads it to him again. Okay. And clarifies it to him. And that'll some of the games that go on to put doubt in other people's minds. So let's see now the final piece on what Senator Lemmer is talking about here.
Senator Lemmer, in what way are you suggesting the right to vote is being abridged or denied? I mean, I can understand how poll taxes, which were subject to litigation under the 14th Amendment, would fit in that category.
Once this system is in place, the public will not have a right to choose an election, or choose a candidate between two or more candidates.
But each voter would have a right to vote. Mm-hmm.
Still a vote.
Choice.
Just a different model.
Well, I guess it's up for courts to decide, Mr. Chair, once again.
We'll let the courts sort that one out, huh?
All right. It's still a vote, it's just a different model. Yeah, that's right, it is a different model. No, it is not still a vote. It's a communist vote, it's a communist election. We don't do communism here, okay? And in my opinion, a number of these people are communists. That's their goal. And they're very sneaky about how they do it. They just don't come out full-fledged. But we're trying to change the way we choose our judges into the communist model. That's what an appointment system is. That's a communist model. You work your way politically as an individual through the political system so that you get that governor and those people on that election committee to nominate you. Okay? But you still get to vote on whether you want the people, after they're already elected in, that the governor wanted, after they're already appointed in, you still get to vote up or down on them 6 years later, whether you like them or not. And if you don't, then the governor appoints somebody. That's not an election. Matter of fact, that's language malpractice. That's literature malpractice, English malpractice, whatever. It's malpractice to call that an election. It's not. It takes away your right to vote for a judge. And that's what's happening. This is a big change. It's denying your right to vote for a judge, and it's denying, and it abridges your right. It changes the way it is. So this will allow us, it's a negative right. We're forced to vote a negative vote rather than a choice for. You see that? A negative right. We can vote against something, but we can't vote for something. And that's a communist system, okay? That's not the American system. In the American system, you get to vote for something and for a person. All right, so it's a very good discussion. Will it be enough to deter the communists from taking away our right to vote? Who knows? But let's go on. We'll go back to my testimony on some other comments I make about the judiciary.
Now, I heard a lot talking about our great judiciary, and if I hear about our great judiciary anymore, it's just going to make me puke.
Mr. Kinley, we're not going to accept commentary or language of that nature or characterizations in front of this committee. There's an appropriate decorum. We welcome your testimony, but not of that sort.
But saying that this is fair and impartial is okay? I'm just trying to,
yes.
It's okay to say something positive, but not something negative.
No, I'm okay. Referring to your language, sir.
All right. So here's what is happening here. In what I see happening by our judiciary is abuse of the Constitution. We the people wanted elections. But understanding there are exceptions to electing judges because judges may need to resign. But what's happened now is the exception where we now appoint is the rule rather than the rule being the rule. The exception's the rule, and the rule becomes the exception. And that's just not right. And that's our judiciary that's doing this.
That was my main point. It's our judiciary that's violating our Constitution, and they're doing it intentionally, and they're doing it for a political reason, okay? And they're the one abusing our Constitution, not the people. And so they build the people for this taking away your right to vote for judge or building this house of cards and saying, oh, look at our system the way it is. It's not working quite right, but we still got the best judiciary in the world, which we don't. The fourth best in the United States, which we don't. That's a smoke and screen. They cover up their crimes. This abuse is happening from the judiciary. And it is an abuse of the Constitution. Now, judges may need to resign, and there may not be enough time to an elected judge. And we built that into our Constitution. That's the exception. But once that is over, our Constitution actually says once that judge is appointed, they stand for election. or there has to be an election after that where the people get to choose. But that doesn't happen because of the internal system that's taking place. Now, we're going to get to the reason that judges are unopposed next in my next clip, but I did use the word puke. Now, I looked up in the dictionary why that was such a bad word, and what it means is to vomit. And so I looked up what vomit meant, and it basically meant to throw up. And so, you know, or it's another word to say I'm sick, you know, and this makes me sick. And it should make you sick. But fair and impartial, that's okay. I mean, it's a positive spin on the bill. And I put a negative spin. It's sickening. This is not about fairness or impartiality. This is about controlling and getting control over a large branch of government by the governor and forming this oligarchy. And, you know, it's also about regurgitating something bad. You know, it's getting something out of your system that's not helpful to your system. So what I should have said if I had been thinking quick enough, because the way knowing the courts, and this is doing a comparison to how the courts operate versus how the legislature operates. So obviously they don't want me to say ugly sounding words, even though they are not that bad. They're not bad. They're not swear words. I don't think they are. They could be, but I don't know. So I could say, well, would it be all right if I use the F-bomb? Would that be okay if I say that here? And of course, Senator Latz would say, well, of course not. And, you know, you better stop this, that type of language. Well, and I would say, well, Senator Latz, you just got to understand that that's okay in the courtroom. So, you know, I've been in a lot of courtrooms, and, you know, I just don't understand difference between there and here. But Senator Latz, how about this? How about if I give you $150, can I then say the F-bomb? Would that be okay? And Senator Latz, no, of course you can't do that. Well, how about if I give you $150 every day for a month? Would that be okay? You know, well, no, of course you can't do that. Well, okay, Senator Latz, but that's what you can do in the judiciary. Because you can give a judge $150. Matter of fact, you can do it multiple times throughout the day, and the judge doesn't have to report it as long as it's under $150. Okay, so that would have drawn out the comparison of what our judiciary is really like versus our legislature. And, you know, if I would have been thinking and quick enough on my feet, I would have said that. But for you to know, that's what happens in our judiciary. So we got a caller calling. So, caller, have you got comments or question?
Well, I have a comment, Tim.
Yes.
If when you were there at the hearing and you had a crystal ball, you could have responded, knowing what was going to be in the future the next week, you could have responded and said, and what is the basis of your community standard by which you are saying that I must speak?
Oh, boy, yeah, that's too funny. We're going to get into that. We got some great video on the community standards. Basis of community standard. Absolutely. Of course, that's what Maplewood is crying out here. These shows don't have the right community standards to be playing over the air. But, all right. Well, let's get to our next clip. We're running out of time already.
And why did 90% of our judiciary, our judges, are unopposed? Remember in Washington County when 24 attorneys filed for an open seat? There were 17 unopened seats or unchallenged judges running in Washington County, 17. But for one open seat, 24 attorneys were running. And I asked a lot of those attorneys, I mean, the odds are against you. You got a 4% chance. Why not at least have a one-on-one race where you have a better chance? And to an attorney, they said to me, the ones I asked, and I asked a number of them, because they have the word incumbent behind their name, and because I'll lose my cases, they will punish me. And when Tom Armstrong, the judge of Washington County that resigned and that made the open seat and a complaint was filed against him, he talked about what it was like to run against an incumbent. And in his complaint, his response to the complaint, he laid out the problem.
All right. Well, that's why judges run unopposed, and that's why there isn't this transparent election system, because our Supreme Court, as in Judge Tom Armstrong's case, pressure him and pressure those people who run against incumbent judges. But people do run against incumbent judges. But typically, in talking to these people that run against incumbent judges, they tell me, I got permission from other judges. So this inside game in the judiciary is, it's okay to run against another judge if you get other judges to get behind you to run against the other judge. But you don't know about it, which makes it highly political. The worst kind of political activity you can have is the secrecy and the intimidation and the browbeating that goes on in our judiciary. And it's got to stop, and it needs to be exposed. Okay, let's talk about power here. Let's go to our next clip.
So what I don't see, as a person who's sat in hundreds of cases, I'm not an attorney, I've been through the court system, I know what goes on. In my opinion, this does nothing to have a transparent judiciary. It will make it less transparent. You got 24 people making the decision instead of the people making the decision. I mean, my vote as a citizen is minuscule, but that I want to get on that seat of 24, because then at least I have about a 5% chance, 4% chance, my power in there. But if I'm on the winning side of who I want for a judge, then I'm around 10%. I have a lot of power. And then, you know, I might even be willing to buy that seat if I could.
I'm just going to ask you to wrap it up, because there are several others that wish to testify on this matter as well.
So, just in the bottom line, the less people involved, the more political it is. The more people involved, the less political it is.
You know, I want to get to that smoke-filled hidden room, you know, and make those decisions. I can get some power. You know, only 24 people get that spot. And let's see, it's the governor that appoints, so if I make my contributions to that governor, then I can get that spot, have a better chance of getting that spot. But, you know, people aren't going to really know who's doing what or what it took to get to that position. That's why we need a transparent judiciary. That's why we need open elections, where these judges have to get out, where people need to find out about how they're ruling and what they're doing. Okay, so that's the end of my comments on that case. People, don't give up your right to vote. But there was other discussion that went on, and Senator Ortman had a couple questions, and she wanted to amend the proposed constitutional amendment to make it more accurately reflect what was really going on. And here's her discussion. Here's part of her discussion. So let's hear what
Senator
she has
Ortman
to say.
And then
Mr. Chair, to Senator Sharon's point, and then an amendment that I'd like to offer. I'm concerned about this proposal at this time, because I think there's been an awful lot of change recently when it comes to judicial elections. It's not that long ago that we had a U.S. Supreme Court that said that the way that the Constitution was being applied in Minnesota was not constitutional. And after that, judicial elections changed not too long ago. And I think that we don't have enough experience yet to say that what it looks like after that ruling is bad or good. I just don't think there's enough experience. And one of the testifiers today admitted that we really haven't had overly political and highly expensive judicial races in Minnesota. And so I think it's premature following that to come back and say, let's change the Constitution and let's put this question on the ballot. I can see where some want some clarification about what we do with judicial elections. I can see that. I just think that this is premature. And again, I'm not sure that it's better than the system that we currently have, because I don't think we've had it long enough, the current system, to really judge it.
All right. And that's a good statement, because our system hasn't had the time. And so I appreciate her statement, but I think she's really trying to stall and slow back this momentum, which I don't know that's there, for this constitutional amendment. Now, Senator Dave Thompson signed on to this constitutional amendment, but I talked to him last Saturday, and he said he signed on because Senator Rest told him that he would be able to provide an amendment to that constitutional amendment that would keep the same election process we have today. And I think they actually can just do this with a statute. They don't have to do a constitutional amendment. But would say, okay, yes, we still get to elect our judges as we do today, but when there is this uncontested judicial seat, we would have a retention election, an up or down vote. And that's actually something I'm very interested in. I don't think we'll have that type of scenario where a judge will run uncontested when we do have a transparent judiciary. I don't think that will take place. But since we don't now, I'm okay with that, okay? But it's, again, getting everything around it to work. Well, Senator Thompson, and this amendment was supposed to be made in the judiciary in this very hearing. It wasn't made. Senator Thompson then took his name off the bill. Okay, now, of course, Democrats or liberals were against amendments when we don't need them, and the law would remain the same. That's what they said about the marriage amendment. We don't need it, the law would remain the same. Of course, now they're changing the law, they're trying to change the law. So there's just a lot of hypocrisy going around here. Now, let's hear what Senator Ortman wanted to amend and how she wanted to amend the law.
But Mr. Chair, with that, I would like to offer an amendment that I asked counsel to draft. And the purpose of the amendment, Senator Rest, I appreciated the change that you made to the question, but I would offer another change. The goal would be to make sure that Minnesotans know what we would be changing from the type of system we have currently, which is a contested election, to what would be a retention election. I think we need to be very clear with the voters, if we put a question on the ballot, what the question is and how, if they vote yes, it will impact them, and how, if they vote no, it will impact them. And so the gist, Mr. Chair, would be to add language that talks about what we currently have. So shall the Minnesota Constitution be amended to eliminate contested judicial elections and instead provide that all judges be appointed by the governor from a list of candidates nominated by a judicial selection commission? It continues on. Senator Restay made a few other edits that I thought could help shorten the question, because I think shorter questions, generally speaking, are better for voters. But I think that if we're going to change to a retention election, we must alert folks, voters, to the fact that we have a system that we will no longer be using. That's the contested election. I hope members will support that in the interests of clarity.
Mr. Chairman, I would oppose the Ortman amendment. I think that the change that I made in the language makes the question put to the voters quite clear that the Constitution is being changed to from the system that is in place to another system, and I don't know that it needs to be repeated in the question.
Mr. Chair,
but it's obviously up to the committee, but I would oppose it.
Senator Ortman.
Mr. Chair, I've heard from a lot of folks that have said that they believe that they would be asked to give up their right to vote in contested elections. And that's why I think this language is very important, so folks have a very clear understanding of what the changes would be. And perhaps, Judge Jude, I haven't spoken with you before. I appreciate the fact that you're here. Is this language that you might be able to comment on, given your experience with the voters in your recent election?
Judge Jude.
Okay, Mr. Chair and Senator Ortman, I agree that a shorter question, I think, is more understandable on the ballot. I mean, it's a judgment I think everyone here would have to read. But I appreciate Senator Rest's efforts to de-editorialize the question she had. But this is clearly more direct. You know, the amendment is more direct as I read it.
Thank you.
there any other discussion on this question? It appears, Senator Ortman, it appears that the essence of your amendment, looks like almost all of it is the same language that we already have here, which you're inserting essentially on line 10 after amended is to eliminate contested judicial elections and instead. That's really the operative language.
It is, Mr. Chair, and I asked counsel to write it out, so, because it would be too hard to read it, eliminating certain language and putting new language in. And so I'm just trying to be as very direct with the voters as possible to say, this is what's going to happen. You will no longer have contested elections. We will have retention elections if you vote yes.
You know, this is amazingly simple thing to do. You need to know what you're giving up. And that's what a constitution question should do. And it should be on, well, actually, there shouldn't be any of these titles. And I give Senator Rest credit for removing fair and impartial because, boy, isn't that a emotional salesmanship going on there. She took that off the title for the constitutional amendment. And so, you know, obviously she realized she was using emotional words that you can't use in the Senate, you know, as I found out. But Senator Ortman's amendment here is really good. Let him know we're losing contested judicial elections. You're losing your right to vote for a judge. And that's serious. But the other question you also need to ask, what are you getting in return for this loss of this right? Obviously, it's not about fairness and impartiality. You're getting nothing. As a matter of fact, you're getting less than nothing. Because you're forming, losing that right to vote, you're giving power over to one person. That's scary. And any time that happens, that should be scary to you. That's going back to a king. That's going back to a dictator. That's going back to the communist form of leadership. Okay, now what should happen? What should the ballot say? The only thing that should be on the ballot, constitutional amendment, the number of the constitutional amendment, and then have the like in the legislature, like Senator Ortman was saying, she's trying to avoid, you know, get this thing concise, but she didn't want the strikeouts and the underlines. And if you're knowing how legislature works, a strikeout is we're taking out these words and the underline is we're adding in these. But that's exactly what should be on the ballot. And the Minnesota Supreme Court says that's what should be on the ballot. That's what they recommend in this last election, because then you know. Then you know what it is, and you got to sell your position out to the public rather than on the ballot sheet that's in front of you. Now, Senator Rest's answer, of course, was, I oppose this because I oppose it. There wasn't any rationale or reason behind her opposing it that she said. And, of course, if you heard her say, "It's of course it's up to the committee, but I oppose." Well, that's a signal. You can vote how you want, but I'm opposing this, so please oppose it, DFL. otherwise, it's not going to, you know, we're not going to defeat this amendment, and that language is going to get on there, and people are going to know more about what's happening to them. Now, sometimes they'll say, they won't say it's up to the committee. They'll say, I oppose this bill, and you should too. That's a signal. You vote how I want you to vote, and that's what the party's position is. Therefore, since you got the endorsement of the DFL, you vote this way. It happens on the Republican side, too. But this is what's happening in this example.